So here are some examples at last. So in this, I'm considering a very simple sliding window example where I'm going to make use of cumulative acknowledgements at the receiver. I'm going to set the timeout value, which is equal to twice the round trip time. And at the sender, the retransmission is mainly due to timeout. In other words, it's going to ignore the duplicate acts. So this is the assumptions I'm making as part of the sliding window protocol. And now let's see what happens. So here I have sent, because my window size is 4, I am permitted to send 4 packets. So I have sent P0, P1, P2, P3. P1 is lost. So in response to A0, because I got this packet, and remember there can be 4 outstanding packets. I don't know the status of P1, nor of P2, nor of P3. But I know the status of P0. Since it has been removed, I am permitted to send one more. Thereby I have sent P4. Now then I've got another acknowledgement for A0. This is a cumulative acknowledgement generated in response to P2. But now, since my retransmission is due to a timeout, I'm just going to ignore these duplicate acknowledgements. So I've got an acknowledgement in response to P2, I've got in response to P3, I've got in response to P4. After some time, I'm going to time out, which is twice the round trip time, and then I'm going to retransmit P1. In response to P1, since it filled up this hole and it received all these packets, which by the way get buffered because your RWS is equal to 4, I'm going to get a cumulative acknowledgement that is going to acknowledge all these packets until A4. Now in response to this, so if you can see here, I've received everything until P4, so my window slided. And now I am able to send P5, P6, P7, P8. So this is the sliding window in action. Here it's the same example as before, but now the retransmission can be due to a duplicate acknowledgement. So this all kind of stays the same. But here, as soon as I got a duplicate acknowledgement, I am going to retransmit P1. I didn't wait for a timeout. But I'm going to ignore these other duplicate acknowledgements because I already acted on the first duplicate acknowledgement. Once this acknowledgement from after receiving P1, once I get an acknowledgement for all the packets, then I'm going to send the remaining packets. As you saw, recovery in this case was much faster than with timeout. So this is more efficient. Go back in is another sliding window protocol that makes state maintenance easy. So it's a simple protocol. So this is what it does. Whenever the sender times out, the sender resends not only the packet for which it timed out, but for every other packet that it previously sent, but it didn't receive an acknowledgement. Not only that, it maintains an RWS of 1, which means that the receiver accepts only in order packet and generates a cumulative acknowledgement in response to this. If any out of order packets comes, it is just going to discard those packets. No acts are generated. This is fine because, as I said, on timeout, the sender is anyway going to retransmit all the packets. Thereby, RWS is equal to 1 is sufficient in this protocol. So naturally, it is being inefficient because even though the packets reach successfully at the receiver, but they were out of order, you are just discarding them. But at the same time, the reason why this is used is it makes the receiver design very simple. It hardly maintains any state. It gets the next in sequence packet, it accepts. Otherwise, it's not going to accept it. So this is a simplistic protocol. So here is go back n in action. So again, the same case, P0, P1, P2, P3, this got lost. So remember, it generated an acknowledgement for P0 because it was received in order, and this is the cumulative acknowledgement. It received P2, P3, but these are out of order, so it just discarded them. It did absolutely nothing. Now the timeout is going to recover the loss of packet 1, but when it is transmitting on timeout, it's not just transmitting packet 1. It's transmitting packet 1, packet 2, packet 3, packet 4 as well. So this is the go back n. It went back and transmitted all the n packets that were outstanding. Now once the ACK for A1 comes, then it is kind of going to proceed further by transferring packet 5, so on and so forth. So here is selective repeat in action. If I were to use the same example as before, where only P1 is lost, selective repeat essentially boils down to the example sliding window protocol. But to show the effectiveness of selective repeat, I'm going to vary a few parameters. Basically, I've set the window size now to be equal to 5, and I've considered multiple losses. Basically, P1 as well as P3 are both lost. Since the window size is 5, this is the usual sender sending 5 packets. In response to the first packet, A0 got sent, so you sent P5. But since P1 was lost, the acknowledgement that you sent is as follows. So this is the cumulative acknowledgement and this is the selective acknowledgement that you have sent. Now in response to this ACK here, the sender has figured out that there is a hole in P1. In other words, P1 didn't reach, thereby it retransmitted P1. And again in response to this ACK here, again the sender figured out that P3 was lost and thereby it retransmitted P3. Now, when P5 came, as I said, because you send the selective acknowledgement, so the ACKs take these form in response to P5, P1 and P3. I'll let you figure this out. So when this ACK reaches the sender here, there are already 5 outstanding packets, P1, 2, 3, 4, 5, thereby the sender cannot send any more packets. Now when this pack comes, this point I am kind of representing again here, so it's the same thing, A2, P5, P4, so A2, P5, P4 has come. The sender is now able to send 2 more packets because you acknowledged P1, P2 as part of this. Thereby it was able to send P6, P7. And similarly, when this ACK represented here comes, it has acknowledged until A5 and you have A6, A7 already out there, thereby you are permitted to send 3 more to make the count 5, thereby you send P8, P9, P10. So as you can see, selective repeat is a lot efficient because it could quickly figure out the holes and retransmit those packets, and not only that, as the window size moves, it's able to send new packets. Flow control is another feature which reliable data transfer protocols can provide. I will cover it in a lot more detail when I cover TCP. Here I'm just going to tell it in passing. So basically, flow control provides a means for the sender to prevent overflowing the receiving buffer. So receiver buffers, depending on the capability of the receivers, they can be small. In other words, sometimes the sender may be very powerful, whereas the receiver may be a dump terminal, in which case you don't want the sender to overflow the receiver buffer. The way the flow control can be handled as part of reliable data transfer is by the receiver informing the sender how many frames it has room to receive. And sender is always going to respect this. For example, even if its SWS is very large, it will not send packets, even though it has packets to send, because the receiver told it that it does not have space to accept these packets. So we will see more of this when I cover TCP. So here is a summary of what we learned in this video. Basically, that stop and wait doesn't perform well, so we relied on windows of packets to improve performance. This is the sliding window protocols. These are definitely more complex. You have to handle a range of sequence numbers. There are different types of ACKs, as well as the actions at sender and receiver in response to events can also be quite complex. In addition to reliability, these protocols can also provide in-order delivery as well as flow control. So we have reached a big milestone here. We can congratulate ourselves. So what we have achieved so far is between two nodes, A, let's say A, B, we can now reliably transfer data from A to B. Network layer as such doesn't make sense here because there are only two nodes, and transport multiplexing, I mean, it's a very small functionality. It can be handled. As you can see, we now have a building block where we can transfer data between two nodes A and B. In future, we will use this building block to make many nodes communicate with each other.